Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you at this time thanking you for all that you do in our lives. We thank you for continuing to bless this nation. We ask you to bless our soldiers that's in harm's way. Be with their families. Guide us all and direct us in the way you would have us to live our lives. We ask you to be with each of us as we go about to do the people's business. Let us be fair in everything we say and do. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Okay. Public comments, Ben Ansbacher. Just remember, you have 3 minutes.
I'll dispense with the pleasantries then.
Okay.
I'm here tonight to caution you about an impending problem. 2 years ago, we had a very embarrassing problem with the tax revaluation. It caused a lot of upset among the taxpayers and caused the revenue-neutral tax rate to be set too low. The problem was caused by weak supervision, failure to ask the right questions, and too much trust on the part of the board in the competence of their specialists. These factors are present today in relation to the Department of Justice, and the possible mess could be worse than the revaluation. Things are already being done that do not pass the sniff test. It is time for this board to get involved, to be sure you understand why and what is being done and whether it is in the best interest of the county. The county is supposedly trying to help the University of North Carolina enforce the federal law called the Hatch Act, even though you've been told the Hatch Act does not apply to universities. That does not pass the sniff test. You were harassing members of Fairness Alamance, whose work revealed that you were filing invalid traffic stop reports with the state, and who are now thought to be opposing re-election of some county officials. That does not pass the sniff test. You were refusing to provide documents to the Justice Department after trying this tactic on the ACLU without much success. The excuse given is you do not trust the Justice Department to keep a secret. That doesn't pass the sniff test. You were intimidating witnesses in a federal investigation by asking for the names of confidential informants and by insisting on spying on every conversation between a county employee and the Justice Department. That does not pass the sniff test. You have lobbied the U.S. Congress to alter the procedures of the Justice Department investigation. That does not pass the sniff test. If and when the Justice Department decides it has seen enough of these antics, it will not be pretty. For those of you who are budget cutters, it appears that in the DOJ suit just filed in Maricopa County, Arizona, the county hired two outside lawyers, one from Phoenix and the other from Washington, D.C. Ka-ching, ka-ching. The suit could well be the model for action against Alamance County, and it asserts that the county signed away its rights to limit an investigation. In our case, talk of legal etiquette, Miranda rights, and bar memberships will be trumped by federal contracts like the community development resolution that you're signing today. My plea is that you obtain outside advice on the proper steps for you to take in order to avoid further risking and embarrassment, even worse than the tax revaluation. Thank you. And again, I'd like to say that I am very grateful for this comment section and for having your meetings on the video, on the internet. Thank you.
Thank you. Is she?
Madam Chair, Commissioners, April 2009, I came before you this issue the first time and got no results, so I filed a complaint with the sheriff. Up until the last meeting, I had no response to it, and Mr. Albright and myself and Mr. Johnson got together at the end of the meeting and had a conversation. I said, the complaint to Mr. Albright, and I'm teetotally not satisfied with his reply. People, this is a uniform traffic report. It is required. Now, let's forget all the road check and everything. If a ticket is written, one of these is required. Ask any law enforcement officer. this is a ticket. There is clearly not room for all this stuff on a ticket. Sheriff Johnson, in that meeting where I talked to y'all about, said, when we stop a car, we write a ticket. There is no form filled out because the information is wrongly is taken from that ticket to give you race, gender, and all kinds of data of that stop. Now, that's on this disc. I made you a little cut of it. You can go back and look at the whole thing. Now, this is not, after a year and a half, jump on Clyde and he's been having a hard time. But to say that that was the correct statement, just beyond comprehension. Any official can get a written opinion from the Attorney General's office. I've made you this packet, and I ask that one of you, or all of you, will take it, write to the Attorney General's office, and ask for a written opinion of this complaint that I made in 2009. And I thank
you. Will you reiterate your complaint? I mean, will you tell us?
Sheriff Johnson stood before this board and said that, and I quote, when we stop a car and we write a ticket, there is no form filled out because the information in Raleigh is taken from that ticket to give you race, gender, and all kinds of data of that traffic stop. Now, that was made 68 minutes and 24 seconds in the video of February 2nd, 2009.
So you're saying that's not right?
That is absolutely wrong.
Okay. Colleen Howell.
I'm going to thank all of you tonight for allowing us to use the county property in front of the old school building to establish the Graham Community Garden. It's been a hard start. The weather and the rain have not cooperated with us. I particularly want to thank Ann Vaughn, who visited our first community garden last fall at the health office. We understand we can't do that again. But I have collected produce there and given it to the loaves and fishes here in Graham and discovered a minister who has more land than we have there, and he wants to start a community garden in at his church in northern Burlington. So I think we're starting a tradition here, but thank you very much, sir, and all of you. There's a bit of grass growing there, but we'll try to deal with that. We're starting the fall garden shortly. Okay. Thank you very much.
I hope you got access to water.
Yes, Graham has provided us access for water. We still have to pay the water bill, but that was part of the problem getting started late. But thank you very much.
Thank you. David Blair.
Hey, how y'all doing tonight?
Good.
Good to see you. I was glad to hear Chairwoman Massey say in a recent interview with WXII Channel 12 News that she was trying to get involved with the DOJ investigation of our Sheriff's Department to see what she can do to help. I was also encouraged by the reporter's claim that Commissioner Massey hopes to resolve the issue of interviewing deputies and other county employees. In light of this development, I'm here tonight to ask the Chairwoman to take some time during the Commissioner comments section of this meeting to outline her involvement and tell us what resolution she seeks. I'd also like to address a point that came up in our September 7 meeting. Commissioner Sutton couched his opposition to the investigation in terms of checks and balances by which one branch of government is empowered to limit the power of another branch. The system of checks and balances has no valid application in this case, as it addresses the interactions of co-equal branches of government, such as the legislative, executive, and judicial branches of our federal and state governments, or, to a lesser extent, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners and the Alamance County Sheriff. The government of Alamance County, however, is not co-equal with the government of the United States. It is subordinate to the government of North Carolina, which is subordinate to the federal government. This relationship is outlined in Article 6 of the U.S. Constitution, which states, "This Constitution and the laws of the United States, which shall be made in pursuance thereof, shall be the supreme law of the land, and the judges of every state shall be bound thereby, anything in the Constitution or laws of any state to the contrary notwithstanding. The senators and representatives before mentioned and the members of the several state legislatures and all executive and judicial officers, both of the United States and of the several states, shall be bound by oath or affirmation to support this Constitution." This is why the oath of office that each of you took upon your election to this board binds you to support and maintain the Constitution and laws of the United States. So as we move forward with this investigation, let us not base our response on an ill-informed understanding of the systems of checks and balances as outlined in the U.S. Constitution. Rather, let us proceed from the proper understanding that our county government, as a government entity, has no choice but to fully and completely comply, and that this board will serve the people of Alamance County far better by making that compliance voluntary than by requiring it to be forced. Thank you very much.
Mr. Blair, I went home and watched the DVD again. I wasn't going to say anything, but you referenced me again, so I'm going to have to speak again. I went home and watched the DVD the next day. Robert Boyer, the Times News reporter, he obviously went and listened to it that night because he quoted it verbatim in the next morning's paper. But no offense, sir, for you to lecture me or us on what government is supposed to be in this country is a total farce. What doesn't pass the sniff test that Ben Ansbarger referred to is for you to assume that you know what you're talking about as far as government and proper avenues in good government. I certainly understand. Checks and balances just as well as anybody in this room. But if you believe that they're supposed to be, that we're supposed to roll over and play dead and say, whatever you want, we're at your beck and call, without following what the judicial processes are, good attorney work processes are, and so forth, it's absurd what you think.
Why would you not?
Because we are not subservient to them.
You are subordinate to the federal government.
I'm not going to.
You have no choice. Let me give you an analogy.
Let me say this to you. We fought an American Revolution in this country against people like you, in my opinion.
I wasn't there.
I know, but like you.
Sorry.
Like you. And
I missed
won,
it.
And we won.
About 200
and
years.
I predict we're going to do it again. We're going to have to do it again, and we'll win next time. But you stood there, and said that I supported resistance. Now you're changing it to a lighter side. Well, he supported checks and balances. So you're coming around a little bit.
In actual fact.
Jesus.
You can check your thesaurus when you get home. Because I did. I wanted to make sure I had characterized your remarks fairly. And I was mildly inaccurate.
Mild.
When I said that you offered strong support for resistance. You made two statements, and here, this is a verbatim quote. "I do not think we should allow an unchallenged approach." And then you talked about that in terms of checks and balance. Check your thesaurus. Challenge, to challenge, is a greater degree of opposition than to resist. And to check is an even greater degree of opposition than to challenge.
I don't need a lecture
so
on linguistics interpretation.
I understated your opposition, if anything.
Well, let's stop this right
they're
now.
They're your words.
I had some liberal professors in college that were just like
you. Let's stop this right now, Kim.
Stop at my foot. He's the one that comes up here every week and insults the intelligence of this board.
He does, and he's going to keep
Well, don't tell me to stop anything.
Well, I want him to stop, too. I want y'all to stop, and let's get on with the meeting tonight, and then we'll work about it. Yeah. Hold on. Let's go to Mike Cole. We need to go on with what we're doing. The public comment is not me arguing here. Thanks, sir.
Thank you, Madam Chair. First of all, I apologize for my attire. I have better clothes, but
that looks fine. Don't worry.
I thought it did too, but I didn't know to. I didn't know to the last minute I was going to get to come. And also, what I want to bring up, if I'm at the wrong place to bring this up, I'll apologize again. But what I want to bring before you commissioners is the influx of mopeds on the streets of Alamance County, and that's why I'm starting with you folks here. What I'm told by law enforcement is most of the mopeds that are on the streets today are driven by unlicensed and uninsured motorists. Most of them are because they have lost their license and there is a resource that they can to mobilize. I almost got hit by one other day. Just by the grace of the Lord, I didn't get hit by one. And it brought to thinking to me, what happens if one hits me? And on the other side of the spectrum, what happens if I hit one of them? I have an idea that it's a wholly different ball game because I have a license and insured vehicles that if I hit one, that person is going to come after me. If he hits me, I have nothing because for all the most part, they have nothing. And so here again, I apologize if this is not a matter for you folks, but I don't know where to start, and that's why I'm bringing it before you folks tonight, because I don't know what to do. And if it, and I'm sure all of you travel the cities and streets of Alamance County, the roads are full of them, and they just dare you. And I don't know what to do.
And I can't answer that. Mr. Albright might can give
state,
some.
The state controls the roads in the county,
mm-hmm.
and the cities have control over their roads.
Okay.
Those are the two.
So who do you go to? I mean, what is the recourse for a taxpayer, I guess?
Or a driver.
Contact our state legislatures and let them know of the problem and see if there can be something that can be done on the state level. Because, again, as Clyde said, you know, we don't have any control over any roads within the county.
But I
would contact your state legislature first and kind of explain your concerns and hopefully they could introduce some type of bill in the next session that would maybe limit some of that use.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you for hearing.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. John
Oaker.
Did I say that right?
Oaks.
John Oaks. Oh, hey.
Hey, good evening. John Oaks, Burlington, North Carolina. Mm-hmm. I'm here in reference to the continued investigation of our Sheriff's Department and his deputies by the Department of Justice. I feel my position is more representative of our community on the whole than that of those that are typically here and seem to fully support the DOJ investigation. I believe sensible people have concluded that it is nonsensical to imply that any potential cost of this investigation to taxpayers is somehow the fault of the Sheriff's Department and or county attorney. Any potential cost associated with this investigation has originated with the DOJ, not with the sheriff or the county attorney. I believe that a person who is honest with themselves and is not blinded by emotions of good intentions or anger, the fundamental question one must ask themselves prior to any other consideration surrounding this investigation must be this: why did the Department of Justice send a letter to Commissioner Macy on June the 2nd advising of this investigation? It is either warranted or non-warranted investigation. If warranted, be forthcoming and tell the sheriff what prompted the investigation. In the United States, people and institutions are innocent until proven guilty. Governments and departments of governments at any level are managed by people. Honest and decent people are always hopeful and want to believe that the people working in government are always unbiased and benign in their motivations and actions and are never politically motivated. But people that are intellectually honest have to acknowledge that that is not always the case. I believe we live in a time where people are so politically motivated rather than truth-oriented in their efforts that bias has become more the norm as opposed to the exception. It is not unreasonable for rational and good people to conclude that when the Department of Justice initiates an investigation into the Sheriff's Department or any department, this alone is a rational reason to pause, question, and ask oneself, what is the truth behind the motive that initiated this or any investigation? In my efforts to determine why this investigation was initiated, I called the DOJ and was advised, that I should speak with Linda, the lead attorney Samantha Treppel. I'm trying to get within that 3 minutes. I was told she would call me back today. I have yet to hear from Ms. Treppel. I acknowledge that Ms. Treppel is in no way obligated to return my telephone call. The fact that the DOJ initiated this investigation without providing any detailed information explaining why should have everyone concerned about the motives behind this investigation. That's not only the professional thing to do, that's the prudent thing to do. I would suggest it is reasonable and expected by the vast majority of our citizens in Alamance County that our county commissioners give their total support to our sheriff and county attorney as they make decisions for our sheriff's deputies and county on how best to respond to the continued investigation. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Ann Robbins.
Good evening, commissioners, Madam Chairman. I know the Alamance-Orange County boundary line subject is not on the agenda tonight, but since today is the last day that the petitions can be turned in, I just wanted to thank you all for your time, your effort, and your consideration that you have given to this important matter. As you know, you basically have the future and the lives of the North 9th Street residents in your hands. This has been a long journey and hopefully one that will finally come to a historic end soon, when the residents will no longer have to worry about exactly where they live and have paid their taxes in Alamance County, voted in Alamance County, and have been sending their children to school in Alamance County for the past 32 years. I especially want to thank Bruce Walker, GIS manager, who since August the 1st has so faithfully been in touch with me every week to compare who has sent in the petitions and has gone that extra mile to make sure all residents got the necessary paperwork. And to Everett Green, Mebane City Council member, who helped me knock on doors and make phone calls to make sure residents sent in their petitions. And to the residents of North 9th Street, who finally will have some peace and know that they can depend on our elected officials to be there for them when needed. And by the way, at last count, all but one resident has turned in their petitions. That's what I call a close-knit neighborhood. Thank you.
Jeanette Evans. Good evening, Commissioners and Madam Chair. I think Ann said it all. I don't need to say anything else. I just want to thank everyone that's tried to help us, Bruce, Everett, everybody that's tried to help us, and we're looking forward to being an Alamance County resident forever. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeanette. Okay. I have no other names. On my public comments. So at this time, I'll close the public comments, and we will go to the public hearing on the Community Development Block Grant Economic Recovery Program grant application. That's a mouthful.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. I will be as brief as possible for you this evening. What you should have in your packet is a memorandum from me regarding the public hearing tonight for the CDBG Economic Recovery Program grant application. As I explained at the last meeting, the county is applying for a $500,000 grant with no local match required under the Community Development Block Grant Economic Recovery Program that's provided by the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. And the purpose of the grant is to do major rehabilitation on 10 homes as well as urgent repair on 8 additional low to moderate income homes. All homes that would be repaired would have to meet the low to moderate income requirement. You should also have in your packet a copy of the authorizing resolution, which staff does recommend adoption of the resolution so that we can move forward with the grant application. Also, I did distribute before the meeting to you another memorandum that came to me today from Michael Walser with Hobbs Up Church and Associates regarding this grant application, and this was just giving a little more background. I just received that today and felt like you all should have that. In addition, the funds under this program are designed for economic recovery and particularly for job creation and job retention. And based on a formula that was developed by the state of North Carolina, they are estimating that this project would create or retain approximately 124 jobs, and this is for contractors, subcontractors, and suppliers to do that work. And the project meets the national objective of providing 100% benefit to low to moderate income persons in the county. And he gave a little additional information here. At the time that this was done, this would have been last summer, the unemployment rate in Alamance County was 11.1%, which is slightly higher than the state's rate at the time of 10.1%. So, but I did want to pass that information along to you all as well. Amanda Whitaker is here this evening from Hobbs Up Church and Associates, who's helped with this project, as well as the scattered site projects that we've done in the past, which is what the housing rehab is similar to. With that, I'll be glad to take any questions you all have at this time, and or Amanda as well.
Have you got applications for this, or is that what you do? You take applications?
We will take applications for that. Basically, we have a list that has been that Hobbs Up Church and Associates maintains as a waiting list, and as we receive funding that matches up, applications are sent out to those folks on the list, so you don't get duplicates, you know, contacting us to express interest. So. But we will also actively seek out additional applications as well.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Oh, that's right. I need a motion to accept this.
I'll make the motion.
Kind of a motion.
Yeah, there's.
I'm sorry. Any public comments? I was rushing through.
Kept us out of trouble.
Yeah.
Just like to bring to Mr. Sutton's attention and maybe some of the other board members that this resolution says county, the Board of Commissioners of Alamance County will substantially comply with all federal, state, local laws, rules, regulations, and ordinances. So that by signing this, you were agreeing to that.
Yeah, for this block grant.
Right.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Very good.
Okay. Any more comments? If not, do I entertain a motion now?
So moved.
I have a motion on the floor.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No opposed. Okay. And at this point, I will close the public hearing. Okay. Grant applications for Holy Betrayal. Brian.
Good evening, Commissioners. Before you tonight, request permission to apply for $350,000 from the North Carolina Department of Justice Environmental Enhancement Grant. This grant requires no local match. We are attempting to pursue the purchase of real property or conservation easements on a 106-acre tract of property currently owned by the Holmes family in southern Alamance County. The site is on the proposed route of the Hall River Trail. It's also an inventoried county historic site. It's involving, as the home, Preacher Holmes House is in the vicinity, approximately 150 years old. And this tract was also identified by the North Carolina Clean Water Management Trust Fund study of the Lower Hall River about 2 years ago, mainly because it sits adjacent to property that's been recognized as environmentally stressed, Cedar Cliff Bottomlands. So, basically, what we're asking for tonight, we've met with the property owners. They're interested in working with the county on this. We think we've located a source of funding that will require no dollars from the county, but we do need your permission as a board to submit an application to continue. And whatever we are able to purchase on this tract will depend on the actual amount awarded by the North Carolina Department of Justice and the appraisal value, of course, of the property. So I'm here tonight to ask permission to proceed and to answer any questions that you may have as well.
Anybody got any questions?
I think it's great.
Okay, do I hear a motion we accept that we grant this approval for application for the Harbor Trail?
So moved.
Have a motion?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, next one.
Right, thank you for your hard work in doing this, too.
Next, we'll move to the county manager's report.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just a couple of meetings I do want to give you an update on. As Ms. Robbins mentioned, the petitions for the any proposed changes to the Orange Alamance line were due today, and those petitions have come in well. The meeting date that we have set with Orange County is scheduled for November 29th at 7 p.m. at the Mebane Arts Center. So we were trying to find a central location, and we were able to work with the city of Mebane to secure that site. So if you'll make sure you put that on your calendar, November 29th.
What's that location?
The Mebane Arts Center.
Mebane Arts, okay.
Yes, sir.
Is that on Saturday? What day of the week is that?
That is a Monday.
Monday. Hold on 1 second, Greg.
It's a Monday night. November 29th is a Monday.
Oh, okay. Okay.
This is the 16th.
Okay. Okay.
And the other meeting that I did want to update you on, we have been contacted by the Piedmont TRAG Council of Governments. As you all are aware, they are looking at merging with the Northwest Piedmont COG. It is on the fast track, and they have requested that we meet with the county and our municipalities for them to share information with us on the proposed merger. And we are looking at meeting right now on Thursday, September 30th. It will begin at 6:30 p.m. This will be a dinner meeting. We'll have Ginger Booker, who is the COG director, the interim COG director, will make the presentation. And I apologize for the quick turnaround, but they're kind of requesting this fairly quick. Right now, we are thinking that it will be at the Family Justice Center. We're going to confirm that tomorrow, but we'll get you the information out on that. But we wanted to make sure everybody had the date of next, not this Thursday, but the next Thursday, September 30th at 6:30 p.m. And that is all I have.
Okay. Any comments on Mr.? Okay.
Temporarily at the Family Justice Center.
Right now, yes, ma'am.
Okay. On the consent agenda, we have the resolution regarding ban on sectarian prayers. Anybody have any comments on that?
In reading that, my understanding is that it goes to Hackney up there in Raleigh. How does that affect us here, Bob?
He's setting the standards for the legislature, North Carolina legislature.
But that has no effect on us.
We haven't taken up the prayer issue. We have a proposed policy. I don't think we've taken that up.
We did that because of Forsyth, though.
Right.
Right.
I don't believe we voted on it, though. I don't think so.
It never was.
It was just mentioned, I think, here.
What's the status of the Forsyth appeal?
I don't know. It's at their appellate stage. I have not heard. I can find out.
Well, I think it's, you're asking what effect. I mean, it's a trickle-down effect. You have something in Washington, you have something in Raleigh, and next thing you know, it's here. I think that's the obvious connection, tie.
Yeah, I think we need to fight it as a board.
Okay.
Well, the Justice Department might come down on us, so we better be careful. Isn't that right, Dr. Blair or Mr. Blair or whatever? I don't think that's in their purview.
Any other comments on it? Then I'll entertain a motion that we...
I make a motion that we...
I'll certainly second it.
Accept the consent agenda.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Accept it in the consent agenda. Okay. Next is commissioners' comments, and let me start first and say that, yes, I did call Ms. Turpley or whatever her name is, Mr. Albright. I had gotten comments, and the letter was sent to me as well, and I called her, and I'm like Mr. Oak said, she's never called me back at this point. I did get a letter from her, and what I asked her for, though, when I called was, can you please tell me what we have done and why you are here? That has not been addressed whatsoever. So at this point, I have turned everything back over to Mr. Albright, and because she's not going to talk to me, and so it's obvious that she's not going to tell me anything that she hadn't told anybody else. So at this point, I don't feel like there's any reason for me to contact her again, because she did not contact me back, and she accepted my letter, and that had nothing to do with what I asked her.
If I may, it's my understanding that the only five people in Alamance County that the investigators cannot talk to
are the five members of the Board of Commissioners.
And I don't know that.
Yeah, that's my understanding.
I do not know any of that. So, anyway, that's where we stand. So, if she can't talk to me, I'm not going to try to get her to do anything else whatsoever, because I have no confidence in her at all, since she won't even address me on the telephone. So, okay, and now, next.
I want to apologize for my outburst. I'm man enough to say it, but people need to understand the emotions involved in this debate. I have fought this issue ever since I've been on this board for almost 14 years. It's a passionate debate. It's an emotional debate. People don't know what hours I spent, some others, in getting our jail built to INS standards at the time. Mr. Ansbarger called me at my house trying to lobby me not to support building the jail to INS standards. I mean, this goes all the way back. Is that not true?
I don't recall.
I do recall. And you came here, and I mean this sincerely. You came here, you lobbied against us going with 287G.
Well, I will say, I was opposed to expanding the jail. Is that what you're referring to?
Right, you called me. You
I
definitely
thought we
didn't
could
want
get by with more efficient management of prisoners, right, so that we, you know, speed them up through the process.
That's okay.
Yeah, I didn't record the phone call, but I'm very passionate about this debate. I think it is a moment in our history that if we do not solve it and solve it quick, our whole country is going to turn, in my opinion, down a path that I never thought I'd see. I worry about it for my kids, my grandchildren, these children, even though maybe I'm not sure how they feel. But I'm very passionate about it. And I apologize for the outburst, but I can't get anybody to debate fairly. Everything that I have seen at Elon, I'm sorry, has been the most one-sided, unfair approach to this debate I've ever seen. When they went to Washington, sat before Congress and had Dr. Professor Weissman from the law school at Chapel Hill, it was the most unfair, one-sided debate I've ever seen. And I guess at a point, you know, you do get I get frustrated. I'm not going to lie to you, because I think we've turned a blind eye to it. I just picked up the paper this morning. California has got a trend in whooping cough that is going to exceed. It's going to exceed a 55-year-old trend that they set 55 years ago. I mean, they've had 9 children die. And I guarantee it's tied to immigration, especially illegal. I guarantee it. Rubella, statewide breakout, Chatham County. We all know what that was tied to. TB scenarios are on the upswing. We've compromised our health standards. We've compromised our worth ethic standards. I just want a fair debate. ACC, the great supposed institution down the highway here, they've never had a fair debate. Never. When I called Janet Friedrichsen about a panel they were going to have, and they were going to have everybody but the other side, you know what the quote was? We don't want to turn it over to a bunch of hotheads. But they were going to invite Attorney Rossi. At a point in time, I get tired of it, and I'm willing to do more than just talk at times. And I got to back away from that, because I'm trying to be civil. I apologize for the exchange we had, but I'll never back down from my opinion that we've got to solve the problem of illegal immigration in this country.
If I may.
And it's not the comprehensive, yes, sir, but it's not the comprehensive, quote, immigration reform we keep hearing, the word comprehensive. That word is clearly intended for open borders and or as few checks as possible.
If I may.
Well, you shouldn't.
Go
seriously.
Ahead. I will not say another word, I promise.
The question of what our approach to immigration should be is, to me, a separate question to the question of this investigation. This investigation, as I mentioned the last time, is about whether law enforcement officials should follow the law when enforcing the law. I think that is a particularly important standard that must be upheld for this country to be what it was intended to be.
What about the citizens?
No. Hold it. That's why we can't do this. That's enough. That's it. No more. This is commissioner's comments is what it's made for.
Forgive me, Ms. Chairman. Don't say it's it for me for anything.
I'm just saying it's for commissioner's comments.
I've been sitting down here for 16 years. I plan on sitting down here another four, and I'm not going to have somebody tell me to shut up.
Well, I'm just saying.
If I have something else I want to say to him, I would ask for permission of the majority of the board, and I think I probably could get that.
Well,
but
we're not going to have no melee like we had the last time.
I think it's rude to look down and tell me to shut up.
I didn't tell you to shut up.
Or be quiet or that.
I didn't say. I said that's enough.
That's what we tell
children. And that's what it is. Well, that's what it is. Because you're acting like children. Okay. Whoa. Next is announcements.
What? No.
The next. No, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
We need some more comments.
Well, I okay. Resent that.
Go ahead. Okay.
I support you for chair because I was trying to be open-minded. All right. But that's the most narrow-minded comment I've heard.
That's your opinion,
from your
too.
Seat since you've been sitting here.
Okay. Thank you.
You guys go back in your corners.
No,
okay.
I'm not going to argue anymore about it.
Okay.
I'm not arguing about it. I just don't want this to come out like it did the last time.
I'm acting like a child. You think I'm not going to respond to it. You're crazy.
That's fine. Go ahead, Ann.
Okay. I get very upset when we have the public, our citizens, come up to the podium and speak, and we want to argue with them, and I don't think we should. I don't, under public comments, this is not what should happen. We should be quiet and listen and give respect to everybody that comes up to this podium. And that's what I'll stand on.
Well, Ms. Vaughn, I'll respond to you. I'll respond to you that my name was brought up tonight. My name was brought up in the last meeting. I made it clear that if my name had not been brought up, I wouldn't have opened my mouth. And I'll say to you, if you think I'm going to have somebody stand there and make an accusation toward me that's inaccurate, or characterization is totally inaccurate, and think I'm supposed to sit here and just say, next. I'm not that weak.
I don't think it's being weak, Tim. Well, I've had it happen to me, and you know it, and I never said a word.
Well, I don't know what you have. I don't really care what gets approached to you. But you supported this Fair and Equal attack ever since this happened. You've been on the sheriff ever since he's, you've been on the board. You know it, and I know it. But, if you think, again, I'm not going to respond to somebody, you're crazy.
I make no response.
Okay. Anybody else?
I would like to have a comment, if you don't mind.
You may.
Number one, I guess I do need to ask Clyde, what is this investigation about?
We don't know.
Allegedly, racial profiling, I think.
I'd like to know that. And
we asked that question, and we were told that we're not going to be told the answer to that question.
So if you go to court for something and they don't tell you, you just go to court, right?
Well, if we get sued, then a different set of rules kicks in.
Okay.
We have the right to discover. Then we'll have a judge to back that up.
Okay, so the process is not really started. Is that what you're saying?
It's in the investigation stage right now. Okay. But the problem becomes when you create a cloud over a department or over a county or over a group of law enforcement officers in that county, that cloud is hard to erase. And that's why we ask, what has happened? Has there been some misconduct by a sheriff's deputy? Tell us who that deputy is, and we'll straighten it out. Now, that's the way we do things in this country.
Okay.
That hasn't happened.
And I did notice in one of your letters that we do not control the sheriff's office.
No.
And that is
sheriff
a fact.
Sheriff is a state official.
Right.
Is there something in jurisprudence or in the, your job as an attorney, county attorney, is there something in your credo or whatever that allows you to ask questions of somebody asking you questions and having that so-called weak form of checks and balances?
There is a rule, a federal rule 11. It requires me as an attorney representing the sheriff to determine if there are charges against the sheriff, so I can advise my client appropriately. Criminal lawyers have that same right. If a person is accused of a crime, they have the right to ask the district attorney to open the file, and they get to look at everything. All the accusations, all the witnesses, all the evidence. And that's what we've asked for here.
So there is, even if you might not want to define it as what we think of the blind lady holding the scales up, checks and balances of your three executive branches or whatever, there is a checks and balances system here, even though you might not put that name on it or whatever, right?
It is under the amendments to our Constitution. Our sheriff's deputies have rights. They have rights in their reputation. They have rights in their work. If they're accused of a crime, those rights have been violated.
Can I make one more comment? Sure. It's not related to anything like that. Actually, I want to commend Brian Haygood. I went out to the trail, the opening of the Shallow Ford Natural Area this weekend. They did a great job, and I think we ought to think about sending him on up to Washington and figure out how to work the budget out, because they did a lot of work for $40,000, and I'm going to tell you, it was very evident. And I just want to tell you how much I appreciate it, and I'm sure the rest of the board feels the same.
Well, everybody spoke but me. And what I want to say is that the people that are here illegally should expect to abide by the same rules and the same regulations that the people who pay the taxes should live by. And we don't expect them to do any different, but we don't expect them to do anything less.
That's it.
Any more comments? Any announcements? If not, we are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.